Welcome, welcome, welcome to the podcast Eat Better Food Today. I'm your host, Ken Counihan, and I'm excited to be sharing insights on why we believe the health and longevity begins with the food we eat. The goal of this podcast will be to inspire, educate, and enable folks to live a healthier life and do it affordably. My wife and I have been on this journey for over 10 years and continue to work on it every single day. 1% of the profits from this podcast will be put towards child hunger, with an initial focus on the poor suburb in America, East Cleveland, Ohio. As a reminder, please subscribe to this podcast and be sure to visit my website, Eat Better Food Today, for links to the show, videos, recipes, books, and articles that our guests provide. On this episode, we're grateful to have Ken Counihan, my first solo episode. We've reached our first milestone, chapter one, 26 episodes since we started the week beginning in January of 2024. I'm grateful we've had some amazing guests every week. 7 chefs, 5 were James Beard nominated, 1 won. We've had 5 doctors and 12 in the farmers category, or those in the health food business, a couple of nutritionists and a wellness coach. 1 guest even had an Oscar nominated documentary called Knife Skills. We continue to evolve what we discuss, but the focus remains on food. Food with a few simple, healthy, local, in-season ingredients that everybody can afford. And we've complemented our health conversations by discussing exercise, yoga, mindfulness, purpose, and volunteering. I will share a few of the comments I've received from listeners so far. One listener said, "Thank you for the wake-up call. I'm stepping away from my current role and taking a pay cut for a much more fulfilling job that will give me more time with family and friends. I've started yoga and focusing on the food I eat." Another listener said, "Thanks for your persistence in creating useful content, inspiring conversations with interesting guests." And another listener said, "Love the local flair and personal stories that make concepts and challenges much more real." Thank you for those comments. I'm very grateful for those kind words. As you know, I like to start out with 2 questions with every show that I believe help to get people thinking about the food they're eating and its relationship to our health. First, I'll share what I had for breakfast this morning. Since it's the weekend, I did a little bit of cheating and had a pastry with my wife at the coffee shop. But Monday through Friday, when I go to the gym and then come home, I make a healthy shake that consists of blueberries, whole milk yogurt, honey, a couple of nuts, walnuts, and pumpkin seeds or pepitas, and then some different protein powders, whey protein, collagen, and creatine. Throw in some honey, a little bit of olive oil, and then a product that I use called mud water, which has a variety of mushrooms that are very healthy for you, that I kind of mix all together for about a minute in a blender, and I have my healthy morning shake. The next thing I usually talk about is the pantry, the home pantry. It's part of any healthy food program. If there's unhealthy food in there, you're going to eat it. My personal experience, we just came back from vacation a couple weeks ago from Cape Cod, came home with some Cape Cod potato chips, and guess what? We ate the potato chips. So they were in the pantry, they were easy to snack on, and we did. So as we know, food is medicine. So in my home pantry, outside of the potato chips from vacation, we typically have a variety of canned beans, dried lentils, dried Italian pastas, Italian flour that I use for my wife who's gluten intolerant, not celiacs, but gluten intolerant, that I use to make pastas and breads, dark chocolate, sparkling water, olive oil, variety of vinegars, dozens of spices, garlic, onions, sardines, nut butters, and honey. When I was at the gym last week, which I mentioned I do every morning, I saw a t-shirt which I cannot get out of my head. It had 3 words: weak things break. I'd rather take a more optimistic view on that t-shirt and say strong things live. And even though I was at the gym and that gentleman's shirt spoke to exercise. It speaks to every individual in their health. If you're not physically fit as you pass the age of 50, or as some doctors are starting to say, even the age of 30, your muscles and bones lose mass. If you're not eating healthy food, you risk the onset of many chronic diseases, which will be an expensive burden for you and our society. Add in sleep, community, and purpose. These all contribute to being strong and having a healthy, long life. So, strong things live. Young and old, being healthy allows you to do the things in life that matter. Be with your family, feed your family, pay the bills, and if you're as lucky as I've been, take some time to travel. Speaking of travel, which led to my health scare, which we'll explore in an episode in a few weeks with my doctor from the Cleveland Clinic, if I had not, with my wife, visited the Cleveland Clinic's functional medicine program back in 2014, I would not be speaking to you today. Yes, the Apple Watch alerted me that I had a problem, and yes, the Cleveland Clinic fixed my problem, thank God. But being on a healthy program through the clinic's functional medicine clinic helped both of us to get healthier and allowed me to survive what happened a couple years ago. Their holistic approach to medicine, asking the right questions, prescribing the right food, the right medicine, the right sleep, the right wellness program, set my wife and I on a path which we are still on today. But we're not perfect. It's not easy to change. It took me a few decades to realize that. But if you listen to this podcast and the guests we have, you can, over time, move in a positive direction. Everyone today has a lot going on in their lives. I just hope through this podcast, with the help of the guests that I've had in this show, to inspire you to head in a new positive direction as it relates to your health. As I mentioned at the beginning of every episode, my wife and I can continue to work on this every single day. So change one thing a week. Add one family meal at home. Add a new in-season fruit or vegetable. Walk 10 minutes. Lift 10 pounds. Add some extra virgin olive oil to one of your dishes. Enjoy a better tasting local food. Do 10 minutes of yoga with a YouTube video. Teach a grandchild about healthy food. Volunteer somewhere. Be kind to someone. On the topic of kindness, I want to share two stories that have stuck with me from the guests that I've had on the show so far. If you've been listening to the podcast, one revolves around a birthday cake, the second one revolves around a post office. So on the birthday cake conversation, basically this was at a food bank distribution site. They get, you know, pallet loads from different grocery stores in whatever region or area they happen to be in. And this particular day, they got a pallet of pastries from one of the local grocery stores. And the food bank is trying to do more and more healthy food options for the people that it serves. And so they were perplexed what to do with the pallet of pastries. So one volunteer smartly started asking people that were lined up, and I guess there were over 100 people in line waiting to get some food, basically asked the question, does anybody have a birthday this week or next week? And she got a lot of hands. And then she finally narrowed it down to, because it was one cake on this pallet of pastries, kind of said, does anybody have a birthday today? And one mother and son raised their hands. And so she gave that birthday cake to that mother and son. And when she gave that cake to the mother said, I did not think I was going to be able to afford to buy a birthday cake for my son today. So an act of kindness by that worker working at that food bank location. And then there's the post office conversation. So basically, someone that we had on the show was in another town, had to go pick up a package at a post office, wasn't having a great day, had their four-year-old son with them, and had to go pick up this package at the post office. So get into the post office, unfamiliar post office pickup situation. And another woman standing there says, everything will be okay. And it just immediately calmed that person down, this person speaking to my guest did not, you know, had never met or known this person, just could see that they just needed a little bit of comfort and, you know, told them everything will be okay. And that my guest said that she will never forget that, changed her whole outlook on that day, and just she continues to think about that one incident. So two acts of kindness, two different situations, but I think everybody's capable of a little bit of kindness in their day. So as I've learned over the course of my conversations this year, these conversations not only apply to those of us over the age of 50, but even more importantly applies to the children who will soon become the leaders in our society. Of the five factors we discuss, food, exercise, sleep, community, and purpose, I would argue the hardest of these five is purpose. So starting with food, today there are hundreds, maybe thousands of books written on food. Good diets, I'll argue bad diets, healthy diets, vegan diets, vegetarian diets, keto, omnivore, dozens of others. Pharmaceutical companies are coming up with drugs to help us lose weight and cure different chronic diseases. Supplements are available to make up for the deficiencies in the food we eat today. It's all very confusing. But I still think the solution is rather simple when it comes to food. Try to buy fruits and vegetables that are in season and in their natural form, like lettuce, tomatoes, strawberries, raspberries, blueberries. And try to eat a variety of colors every day. Eat a rainbow. Don't just buy the green pepper. Buy an orange pepper. Buy a red pepper. When you buy the different fruits, they, you know, raspberries are red, blueberries are blue, strawberries are red. Just try to eat a rainbow of colors on a daily basis. They all have different health benefits, which I hope to explore on a future episode. And if you can afford it, any food where you're eating the skin or the leaf, try to buy it organically. I know there's an expense difference there. That's why I say if you can afford it. The alternative would be try to find a local farmer that doesn't use chemicals. Go to a farmer's market. They typically provide food from farmers that do not use chemicals. Also, local grocery stores will highlight, you know, local produce, and try to, you know, go to those local grocery stores that have the local produce from farmers that don't use chemicals. When you can't buy in season, go for healthy products like the dried lentils that I have in my pantry, canned black beans, chickpeas, kidney beans, pick your favorite bean that can be part of your healthy diet. Try frozen corn. Typically that's taken right off the cob, frozen immediately, so that's a good alternative when corn is not in season. Fermented foods are always good for you. They're very good for the gut, which means very good for the brain. Things like pickles, sauerkraut, kimchi. And try to remember to look at the ingredients when you're buying things in the store that are coming, you know, cans or packages, to make sure, again, we've talked about this many times, less than six ingredients. If you're reading the ingredients and you don't understand them, put it back. The interesting thing about eating healthy and eating good food is that it's also good for the environment and the climate. If those farmers aren't using chemicals, it's not getting into the environment, the streams, you know, waterways, air, etc. So you're not only doing the right thing for you, but also for the planet. You'll be happier, your mind will be clearer, your friends and family will enjoy you more, and your children will thank you. Exercise is the second thing. So also there are many articles and books written on this topic. A lot of videos, a lot of things out in social media and on YouTube. So exercise, in my opinion, can be boiled down to just starting with a 10-minute walk after a meal. If you can do 30 minutes, even better. If you can run a mile, even better. Just like with the food, just try starting some just basic walking for 10 minutes and try to work up. If you can get to the gym and use weights, even better. If you can spend a few dollars at a sporting goods store to start out with a few simple weights and some bands, even better. Everybody has access to YouTube, and there are plenty of exercise and yoga programs out there. And if you can afford to start with a personal trainer, they're typically not very expensive, like under $100 a session, at least in the Midwest here. Try to get a personal trainer, at least get you started on the right path, so that way you're doing things that are not, especially if you're over the age of 50, things that are not going to hurt your body, but improve or at least maintain your muscle mass going forward. And then you can just kind of move on it and do things on your own. So the next thing, the third thing would be sleep. again, this gets a lot of research, but I think I've listened and read to enough things that it seems like 7 to 7.5 hours seems to be the sweet spot from what's typically recommended. But you'll know how many hours your individual body needs based on how you feel in the morning. So after 6, 7, or 8 hours of sleep. So again, listen to your body, get the right amount of sleep that makes you feel good in the morning. Just as with the food you eat, the exercise you do, make sure you're doing things that make you feel good. Community is another area that's fairly easy to solve, and we'll have a guest on shortly on the show that will discuss this as well. Community can be playing board games with friends on the weekend, can be playing video games with friends, can be going to an event, concert, football, basketball, baseball, hockey, pick your favorite sport. Just be sure to go with a friend. Community could also be volunteering for an organization, going to church, helping a neighbor. As one of my guests said on an earlier show, volunteering is good for the soul. So those are the first four areas. As I said a minute ago, the final area of purpose is probably the hardest. When I started this podcast, I thought I had found my purpose, inspiring, educating, and enable folks, young and old, to live a healthier life and do it affordably. What I began to realize over the last 6 months is my purpose has always been about helping people. When I was in IT in different roles in finance, consulting, and sales, I was always searching for what was the best technology solution that could help my customers. Whether it be Hewlett Packard or Dell desktops, laptops, tablets, storage devices, networking, mini computers, supercomputers, or today AI computers, you get the idea. Every business has a need that can be helped with technology. And if I can provide the technology to help that business person or organization be more successful, then I would be more successful. It was a win-win. So I finally realized I'm continuing to do the same thing I've been doing in IT sales for the last 30 plus years. My purpose that took decades to realize. One area we will continue to focus on with guests on future shows will be with child hunger. As you all know, we're trying to build a new center in East Cleveland with the help of the Catholic Church, other organizations in East Cleveland, the food bank, hospitals, the county, and foundations focused on food as medicine. This facility is still being designed, but we'll be having a teaching kitchen as well as a central kitchen. Food and clothing distribution will be included. Teaching. Not just providing food and clothing, but teaching people how to become more self-sufficient. As a recent guest said, Dr. Thea James, a couple weeks ago, teach everyone how to thrive, not just survive. I learned from my grandparents the importance of gardening, harvesting your own food, making your own meals. From my parents, I learned the importance of having regular family meals. If we can teach those aspects to the children at this new center, they will become healthier children, and in the future, healthier adults and future leaders. They'll be better prepared to learn in school, better prepared to play sports, better prepared to help in the community, and indirectly, as I've said many times, helping the environment. East Cleveland went from one of the richest suburbs in America back in the John D. Rockefeller era to the poorest suburb in America. You can look at that city and say it's a huge problem, or you can look at it as a huge opportunity, which is what we look at it as. Thank you for continuing to listen and support the conversations on this show. We are working to make Chapter 2 as interesting, inspirational, educational, and as enabling as Chapter 1. As for the recipe this week, we'll post on the website. It's a healthy, easy, sloppy Joe recipe. My wife and I eat it without a bun or rice, but feel free to add those to yours. The recipe has lots of vegetables, spices, and of course, hamburger. No mix is included here. The spices that we include here, things like cumin, coriander, paprika, kind of make up for, and pepper and salt, of course, kind of make up for anything you would find in a mix. It's delicious. The whole house smells great when you're making it. And as with any of our recipes, feel free to add it to your own, repertoire of recipes and add your own twist to it. So have a great week. Gratefully yours, Ken. Thank you.